Welcome back. And we're going to be continuing our conversation about the future of money. And in particular, as we change money, it also needs regulations. So I've got three experts in that area to talk about that today. So Donna, Redel, professor of blockchain, also with New York Angels, Vince Molinari, CEO of Templum Markets, and Dina, Rochkind, the lobbyist with Paul Hastings in Washington, D.C. So thank you very much
for being
here.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you.
So let's just start with kind of an overall discussion of what are the current trends that's going on in this space in Washington. So can you each give me kind of a couple of sentences of what you're seeing now?
Well, I think at this particular time, you're seeing the SEC being proactive in terms of issuing settlements and giving direction. It might not be the direction that everybody in certain everybody thought was going to happen, but on the other side, it's a direction that many of the people in the legal and regulatory space believed would happen.
Okay, so at least we're getting some direction, because I know for a while there was kind of like just hearings and things. So Vince, what are you seeing?
I'd agree with Donna. I think we're seeing, as Templum and Templum Markets have been advocating, that much of this space is securities. So I think market participants, by virtue of the direction, whether that's 21A reports, investor bulletin speeches by the SEC, have clear direction that this is securities. And so I think that's beginning to change the landscape and a migration to a securities practice.
Okay. And Dina, you are there in Washington. What are you seeing on the ground?
Yeah, I agree. We're seeing a lot more regulation. But I really applaud the SEC and the Treasury Department and the other agencies for being very tactical in terms of their regulations.
Now, we've got a changing Congress. So we'll have a Republican House now, or a Democrat House now, still Republican Senate. How does that change any of this, or does it at all?
Donna? Personally, I don't think we're at the point where we need new legislation that derives from the Congress.
Dina, you're in Washington a lot, so, I mean, do you have a sense of who the players are that are important in this space? Who are the ones that are proponents? Who are the ones that are cautious?
Sure. So, I mean, I think that we do see some more interest in Capitol Hill, which makes the SEC more interested, because there is an interconnection with the Hill and the SEC, and they both talk to each other. I mean, the key player is really, you know, the change in the House of Representatives is a significant change for a variety of reasons, but even in this space, because you have, you know, Maxine Waters, who may want to do more oversight maybe she thinks things aren't moving along as fast, but you also have the new ranking member is likely to be Patrick McHenry, who's the deputy whip now, but is known in the fintech and in the crypto space. And this may actually be a place where we can see compromise.
So those are the folks to watch. So, and Vince, I know you go to Washington a lot and testify and kind of educate them. How would you say Congress is? I watched a hearing, I don't know, 9 months ago or so, and I was like, wow, they got a long way to go. And I'm not even an expert in this field. So how would you kind of gauge their understanding of this issue, blockchain in general?
You know, I would say much akin to a lot of the marketplace in the last 12 months have gotten much more educated and up to speed. And I think congressional and Senate staffers have really done a great job at digging in and learning about the space. But I'd fully agree with Dina here. I think this is one area where you can have real bipartisanship.
There's more than one area that we're talking about. And you're talking about blockchain, and you're also talking about easing some of the investment rules that really aren't specifically related to blockchain.
2017 and 18, to an extent, was kind of a little bit Wild West, and especially in the ICO space. And I think we just saw Floyd Mayweather was, you know, kind of somehow punished for his role in things. Has that seemed to be cleaned up now? What's each of your opinions on that?
I think cleaned up, it's just getting cleaned up. I think there's two aspects to that, at least. One is, for the most part in the United States, ICOs have ceased to be issued because they're clearly, as Jay Clayton said, a security, and a security needs to be registered.
And Dina, talk about, I know there's sanctions against Iran. I mean, is the U.S. on top of the situation if Iran, say, would wanted to use cryptocurrency to kind of get around sanctions? Where are we with that?
Yeah, I think the U.S. is very much on top of this issue. And I think this area of law, when it comes to sanctions and anti-money laundering, would be the biggest threat to crypto or DLT and blockchain.
So we've seen Bitcoin 70-80% down this year, 2018. Do you think that that has helped in terms of writing some clear legislation? I mean, it was a bubble at the end of 2017, and now maybe since it's a little more down to earth now, will that kind of help clear heads and write some meaningful legislation?
I think it's more macro than that. First, I think the visibility and awareness that was brought by Bitcoin, Ethereum, and others really demonstrated this wonderful technology and what could be done with it. I think we're seeing a migration to more stabilized assets or digital assets set of securities. And I have to say, I think CFTC and Lab CFTC, as well as NASA and some of the state levels, are really getting very involved in taking some leadership positions.
I think everyone is starting to realize you've got to comply with securities laws. That's taking some of the speculation out.
It sure is. So thank you so much for joining us, Dina, Vince, and Donna. And thank you as well for joining us. We'll be right back.